discussing with you. Our next speaker is Dr. Mohan Rajan. Harshul, that was a nice talk.
Thank you.
And he's going to take us on to managing posterior capsular rent. Your take-home points for a PCR management. This is a preferred practice guidelines. I want crisp slides.
Yeah. Thank you, Chitra. Within the next 6 minutes, I'm going to talk about the posterior capsule rent. As you know, when you have a posterior capsule rent, if you use coaxial irrigation aspiration, that is going to make the matters worse because it's going to enlarge the tear and more and more vitreous is going to start coming into the anterior chamber. And this is going to make it's like a tsunami. So always use a bimanual irrigation. It's very important. If you have a small PC tear, then convert that into a PC posterior capsular rexus. This is very, very important because you can go ahead with the posterior capsular rexus is always very, very strong, and you can go ahead with the lens implantation at the back as well. So again, very important again, when you have a PC tear, do not pull out. If you pull out of this, I think what happens is a small PC tear becomes a huge PC tear, and you can see the nucleus also going inside into the vitreous cavity, and the vitreous starts coming into the anterior chamber, and what is a small tear initially becomes a very, very huge tear. What do you do when you have a PC tear? Always inject viscoat. I don't have any financial interest. Viscoat. See what is happening. When you inject a viscoat there, you can see the small PC tear. That viscoat goes and tamponades the break. And then once you stabilize the anterior chamber, slowly withdraw the phaco trib and then go in for a bimanual. Once you have a PC tear, switch over from the coaxial to the bimanual. That is create a right side port. And that is what I want to tell. Again, you can see here, I'm trying to go after the nucleus, the posterior polar cataract, you can see what is happening. There is a PC tear, a sudden deepening of the anterior and posterior chamber. I am injecting viscoat there and coming out, immediately creating a right side port, put tricot there. Identify the presence or absence of vitreous in the anterior chamber. Remove the vitreous first. Use always a bimanual automated vitrectomy. No, don't use a DVCUS or don't use a sponge or something like that. Always remove the vitreous first and then remove the cortex as well. So this is again very, very important. Can say anterior vitrectomy through the pars plana is also very, very important. Nowadays, the pars plana route is also as advocated by Abhay Vaswada. The pars plana route is supposed to be very easy. You can see this particular patient had a vitreous in the anterior. This vitreous is floating in the anterior chamber. There's a blob of the vitreous in the anterior chamber. There's an IOL in portion as well. And you can see that what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to go in and try to remove the vitreous by having an anterior chamber maintainer. But more importantly, I'm removing the vitreous in the anterior chamber, but I want to remove the vitreous more effectively from behind. So always create a pars plana entry. I'm trying to remove the vitreous from the anterior chamber. And then I put a trocar and cannula and go inside into the vitreous cavity. This is an anterior chamber. You can see and removing vitreous from the anterior chamber. Now, once I do that, you can see the vitreous is still there, presence in the vitreous. So you can't remove the vitreous from the limbal root totally. That is important. So you need to go behind and remove the vitreous because you can remove less amount of vitreous, less traction on the vitreous base as well. You can see here, once I put a trocar and cannula, and you can see how beautifully this vitreous, which is there in the anterior chamber, comes off. And that is, again, a very, very important message. And the trocar and cannula is not very easy, very difficult to put. Just measure 3.5 millimeter from the limbus. If you don't have a trocar and cannula, you can always put a sclerotomy with the 20 gauge needle as well. Again, and as you can see, this particular patient, I'm putting preservative free tricot diluted there and putting a trocar and cannula into the posterior chamber into the vitreous cavity and removing the vitreous from behind and keeping an anterior chamber maintainer there and then removing the vitreous from behind, which makes life very, very easy for all of us. Once you do that, you can see that once you remove the vitreous and then the cortex as well, always I told you, remove the vitreous and then remove the cortex. Always use bimanual techniques and inject viscoat or Visulon or Hyalon or whatever it is. When you come out of the eye, stabilize the anti-chamber. This is a very small PC tear. You can see here I'm trying to put a single piece Agrisoft lenses into the bag because I know it is a small PC tear. It will not extend and the patient is doing very well after that. So once you have a larger PC tear, you can see here, I'm trying to put a do an optic capture. Again, this optic capture, you can see here, this is a large PC tear in the posterior polar cataract, very typically two pillars of the on the posterior capsule. The optic capture is done by the haptic is placed in the sulcus and the optic is captured into the capsular rexus margin. The end point is the ovalization of the capsular excess margin, which is again very, very important for you to understand. This lens will be stable. This will not move a micron. There's no possibility of a Huguette syndrome. You can see this 2 months, 6 months, 2 years, and how stable these lenses are. The take-home message, PPP in PCR, or the preferred practice patterns in PCR, is small PCR convert into a posterior capsular excess. Do not pull out, stabilize the anterior chamber by injecting viscoat. Use tricot preservative free. Once you pull out of the eye, and once you come out of the eye, make sure that you remove the vitreous first by using a bimanual automated anterior vitrectomy, either a limbal or a pars plana, whatever you are comfortable with. Remove the vitreous first and then remove the cortex and the epinucleus, and then appropriate IOL depending on whatever the capsule is there, whether the posterior capsule is there or remove the anterior capsule is there. If you have removed the anterior capsule intact, then you can do an optic capture. I always prefer to suture the wounds when you have vitreous loss, because the incidence of postoperative endophthalmitis and leaking wounds is so very, very high in these patients. Thank you very much for the wonderful opportunity.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mohan Rajan. They were very crisp take-home points, and that was exactly the essence of this whole session was. So, Hari Priya, I have to ask you a question, and Mohan, you stay glued on. When would think of doing a posterior optic capture as one other solution for preferred practice guidelines with a PCR, Dr. Hari Priya?
Just to have the good IOL support, then I would do a posterior optic capture. Yeah. I just also wanted to add that it's great if one can do a pars plana vitrectomy, because that the only aspect that it needs additional skills. So I think I also feel that an anterior vitrectomy done well may also work quite well in most people's hands, only to ensure that there's no traction on the vitreous base when it's being done.
Mohan, when would you do a reverse optic capture when there is a PCR?
When I have a toric lens, okay, when I have a PCR, I put a toric lens, then I put a reverse optic capture. The reverse optic capture is the other way around. The haptic is in the back, the optic is in front. That is the reverse optic capture. So that's what I would do in a patient. You were asking about the previous case where in the high myopia and the toric lens is moving. I would put up a CTR, but I would do a reverse optic capture in this patient.
I beg to differ on that. I would want to know from Hari Priya too. I would do an optic reverse optic capture if there is a little larger PCR in the capsular bag where I know I can leave the haptic, but I'm not happy about leaving the optic in the bag, is when I would bring it forward and do an optic capture. Hari Priya, any difference in thought?
I also find it difficult to do a reverse optic capture.
Like a small rectus.
Single piece lens, because it doesn't stay. With a three piece, it stays. Most of the toric lens comes on a single piece platform. Yes. It normally goes back when we form the AC. So I think, I don't know, is it a specific lens you would use for that, sir?
No, I use the IQ toric lenses only, what I have done. And it's not difficult at all. The reverse optic capture is not difficult because the lens is in the bag and you just have to pull the optic up a little. That's all. Okay. And so the reverse optic capture is not difficult at all. But of course, the multi-piece lens is much easier. And of course, in pseudo-exfoliation, all the pseudo-exfoliations, I don't put the lens nowadays in the bag. I always put it in the sulcus, the multi-piece lenses, and then optic capture I do now. So, because this David Chang has shown in this study as well, that long-term stability of the lenses, the pseudophakodynosis, everything is much better when you capture the lenses.
Dr. Jagdish Reddy, could you share your screen? Gaurav, you have anything to add here? If there is a large, unmute yourself, if there's a PCR, what would you do if you have a planned toric IOL in this patient?
So that's always going to be tough if it's. Are you asking me, ma'am? I hope
yes,
it's
asking
me.
Yes, asking you. Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So I would, if it's a small rent, I will obviously want to convert it into a capsular excess. So many times I'm actually able to do it. And it's best to act on it like immediately, because you can actually prevent vitreous from coming forward, make sure that, you know, you can keep the vitreous behind and manage the PC rent. And so many times you can actually put the toric in the back if the vitreous is managed correctly. But if it's a big rent and the stability of the IL is not possible, then I would sometimes either abort it, or as you said, you know, you could actually put the haptics behind and do a capture, but the capturing a single piece lens is very unpredictable.
Yes.
So sometimes it just doesn't work, you know.
Exactly. So I wanted that message across. Thank you.